Hello, Minnesota. Welcome back to the Tony Hernandez Show. I'm Tony Hernandez. Today is Saturday, February 16th, 2013. We're coming to the end of just an absolutely incredible week in terms of news and current events and new things happening in our world. We have a great show for you today. We're broadcasting live from White Bear Lake, Minnesota at the SCC Television Studios. Thank you for being here. Thank you for everyone who is continuing to tune in every Saturday. And for those of you who are watching it on YouTube, I can't tell you how much it means to have you watching this show and sharing it with your friends and family. We're going to be broadcasting live here every Saturday from here on out, talking about the latest news, current events, politics, the economy, everything that's going on right here in Minnesota and beyond. Excited to have a great show, great guest today. Today with me, I have the Minnesota College Republican Chair candidates. There's a big election coming up in April to decide who's going to be the next chairman of the Minnesota College Republicans. To my left, I have Mr. Andrew Hasek. Andrew, thank you for being on the show.
Thank you, Tony. I appreciate it.
Yeah, thank you. And I have Danny Surman here as well.
Thanks a
lot. Who's also a candidate for the chairman of the Minnesota College Republicans. So I guess just to start, I'm going to give you all brief 30 to 60 seconds just to talk a little more about who you are, why you're running, and by the coin flip, who was it that was going to start again?
It was me.
Okay, well, Andrew, why don't you go ahead?
Well, my name's Andrew Hasek. I attend the University of St. Thomas. I'm a political science double major and econ as well. I've been with College Republicans there since my freshman year, and when I came to St. Thomas, that was one of the first things I wanted to do when I got there. It's kind of been a tumultuous ride at St. Thomas the past 3 years with College Republicans. There was a lot of activity going around in 2010. We really fell off the next fall in 2011, and then I became chairman last April in 2012 and put in the groundwork, everything that we saw come out of St. Thomas for the fall.
Okay, well, thank you. And Danny?
Yeah, so I'm Danny Surman, and I go to McAllister College. I'm a poli-sci major, media studies minor, and the interesting thing about McAllister is that, yes, there actually are Republicans there. When I started attending my freshman year, fall 2010, we didn't actually have a chapter, so I worked to get it started. Later on, I became the chairman of that chapter, and today I'm now the vice chair metro of the entire Minnesota College Republicans. So it's been a long, fun ride these last 3 years now, working with the College Republicans, working with Republicans in the state. I'm looking forward for it to keep going.
Nice, nice. Well, again, thank you for having me here. Can you just briefly explain, both of you, a little more about the election process? When is the election and how they're chosen?
Yeah, I'll start off on that. The election will be in April. It's the 19th, 20th. We have a convention, and that's when all of the delegates from all the schools that have a college Republican chapter meet. It'll be probably in the metro at an area yet to be determined. And based on your size and email list, you are allotted a certain number of delegates, and schools send their delegates to choose the chair, more or less. Mm-hmm. Majority wins.
And Danny, you two are both the candidates. Is there anybody else running at the race, and is there any rumors of other people getting in?
As far as I know, this is it, which is really remarkable because Andrew and I actually live within three blocks of each other. So it's always great to have two people who know each other pretty well, live right next to each other, get each other. Definitely. Being able to run against each other. It'll be fun no matter what happens. Mm.
Great. Well, let's get into the questions here. Now, I've prepared a number of questions, and the way that will happen is one person will get a chance to answer, and another person will get a chance to answer, and I'll move on to the next question. Unless you need some time to maybe rebuke a statement or whatever, you can just let me know accordingly, and we'll go with that. We're going to keep it a pretty loose format here and really try to just focus in on the differences between you two and what you each bring to the table in terms of being the next chairman of the Minnesota College Republicans. So first question that I want to ask you is, what, in your opinion, is the role, or what do you see your role as if elected chairman in 2013?
If elected chairman, the chairman is responsible for all of the chapters within the state. And now how I view it is that, you know, there's all these different unique colleges in Minnesota. They all work differently, and so probably the best way to help out a chapter, either starting a new one or, you know, making an older one better, is to get them the resources, communicate with them, and make sure that they have enough funding, and always just be there for them in the end.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, really, the college Republican chairman is the most hands-on resource that a college campus can have for starting their own college Republican chapter. Not only that, we can provide the kind of liaison between the state activists, the state party, the people who know what's going on with politics, and these college students who, some of them, especially freshmen, don't know exactly what's going on yet about politics in the state. We can kind of hold their hand, not even just that, but set them on the path to be able to do their own activism to really help Republican candidates win, which is what this is all about. So in that regard, the college Republican chairman really is a reservoir of information, but also, of course, funding and the institutional connections that chapters need.
Okay, good. Next question is, and Danny, you'll go first on this one, is what distinguishes yourself from Andrew?
Right. So as the vice chair, Metro, and Andrew being the chair of the St. Thomas College Republicans, I've had a great time working with him this past election. We both helped our candidate in our local area, Andrew Ojeda, do pretty well there, all things considered. And so I think that Andrew's done an amazing job with St. Thomas's College Republicans. I, too, worked on my own college chapter at McAllister a few years ago, especially, but even, of course, during this election, I needed to draw on them. But really, as Vice Chair Metro, I had to work with college campuses across the metro area, and not only that, across the state. And so I think that while Andrew's done an amazing job at St. Thomas, I have the experience that we need to work with all college campuses across the state, with whether it was door knocking in dorms in St. Cloud, or it's lit dropping in somewhere like Duluth for Chip Kravac, whatever it is, I've had the experience across the state to be able to help our chapters, no matter their geographic location.
Mm-hmm. And Andrew, what distinguishes yourself from Danny?
Well, what distinguishes myself from Danny mainly is that I've had the hands-on rebuild of a chapter. St. Thomas was nothing when I took over as chairman. We had maybe five people coming to meetings. No one was excited. We had no continuity plan going into the fall of an election year. And the chairman didn't even meet with me before he left and graduated. And so I took over with nothing, even had financial difficulties. And so I had to privately fundraise in addition to setting all of this straight. And so what College Republicans needs to focus on in 2013 is growth. And that's exactly what I've done at St. Thomas. And I think that I've definitely shown that. Danny has definitely had done a very good job of organizing chapters, but I can also provide that as well. But then in addition, have the motivation, desire, you know, the courage to go out and start growing these things again.
Okay, good, good. These are great answers you guys are giving. Andrew, I have a question for both of you now. Can you explain to the audience a little more about the tradition and history of Minnesota College Republicans, and also offer, in your opinion, who do you think the best chairman or chairwoman to date is of the College Republicans, and why?
Okay, starting with the first part of the question, I would have to say the history goes back, well, the organization itself, the CRNC, is extremely old and is one of the...
CRNC is?
Yeah, it's the College Republican National Convention, or Committee, excuse me. And they've been around since the late 1800s. And so Minnesota, of course, has the Minnesota College Republicans, but above that yet is the CRNC, which also helps coordinating within different states and all of that. But the role, at least since I've been involved, was in 2010, up in Duluth, the College Republicans there were a major force in getting Chip Kravac elected and beating Jim Oberstar, who'd been congressman for a very, very long time. And so if run well, we can provide the manpower necessary to put a candidate over the top. And that election was extremely close. And so that's what I'm looking for College Republicans, is to kind of be the force to help push candidates over the edge into victory. And, you know, we did really well in the 2010 elections here in Minnesota and took both the House and the Senate. And I'd think that, I'm sure there's College Republican influence that played into that. Going to the chairman part, I would say that the current chairman, Ryan Lick, of 2 years, has done an excellent job. I mean, two-year chairman is pretty well, and Ryan communicates fairly well with all the chapters. He's a great speaker, has a lot of contacts, and just provides pretty much whatever all our chapters need.
Okay, Danny? Same question.
And the interesting thing with the College Republican Organization is that some of the biggest names in national Republican politics actually started in it, whether it's Mitch McConnell, Karl Rove, Borton Blackwell. All these people who are really heavy hitters in national politics who can swing races got their start just at this small of a level. So it's really a great breeding ground for our activists moving into the future. As far as my favorite chair, because I've only been in college so long, there's a heavy turnover in College Republicans because we're all here about 4 years.
Hopefully.
Right.
Yeah.
And so when that's the case, I've worked with Tyler Vary and Ryan Lick. Both of them, I think, did a great job as chairman, given whatever challenges they were had thrown at them. Actually, a few years ago when I was a freshman, I ran for the treasurer of the College Republicans with Tyler Vary. He actually was just recently ran for state senate and did a great job with that, with the challenges thrown at him. But of course, Ryan's done a great job for the last 2 years now, really bringing back the College Republicans into a force working in electoral politics. And I'm happy to see all that growth that Andrew talked about already.
Okay. The next question is, who's up here? You're up, Andrew?
Yeah.
What will be, if elected chairman of the Minnesota College Republicans, what will be your top priorities in 2013?
My top priorities are going to be recruitment, as I've said, based on my experience at St. Thomas. Fundraising is a huge thing in an off year, and with the experience I have, the context that I have in Minnesota, that's also going to be huge. I'd also like to work more with student governments across Minnesota and making sure that all of our chapters have a voice, at least in student government. I want to work with minority groups on campuses in communicating our values to minorities, because I think that we need to go more out of our way to, you know, accommodate those individuals, and that's about it.
Okay. Danny?
So I think a lot of what Andrew was just talking about are really admirable things to look at, and I would definitely be interested if I do end up becoming the chairman at looking at those things. But really, the biggest priorities I would look at, the top three, would be recruitment, which is two different things. One is the recruitment that we have to be physically on college campuses when they open up for the year, talking to freshmen who don't really have formed political opinions yet before they form those ideas. Really talk to them about the College Republicans, be not just a political group, but also a social group where they can come, we can bring them into the organization before they get other commitments and really learn about the principles we're talking about. So there's that type of recruitment, but there's also recruiting horizontally. That is, other people who are already involved in student organizations like CFACT, which is a free market environmentalism group, Young Americans for Liberty, which is a libertarian student group, Students United for Israel, or Christians United for Israel, is another group. These types of groups already have people mobilized that we can bring into the fold because they share our values just like we have. And so we need to bring those people in. And then the last thing, of course, is what Andrew was talking about, fundraising. I think we really need to look at the fact that if we can throw some institutional support towards door knocking, towards lit dropping, things of that nature, phone banking, if we can provide financial resources towards that, we can make the College Republicans have a much bigger impact than we have today. And I look forward to sharing more details about that in the future.
Mm-hmm. And can you, either of you, just quickly summarize what is the annual budget of the College Republicans? How much was raised in the last year, and how much is expected to be raised in the coming year?
I'm going to give a ballpark estimate on this. I'm going to guess that Ryan maybe brings in $15,000 to $20,000 a year, maybe a little less. I'm not sure with an election year and a non-election year. I'm sure it differed from his first year and his second year. He's got some donors he goes to.
Does that sound about right in terms of
the
numbers?
Yeah, that does. Generally, when the College Republicans go to fundraise that we're dealing with, I think that budget would be about right. And it'll be, a given project might be in the thousands of dollars, or it could be as small as just buying pizza for getting people from St. Thomas or McAllister to go phone bank. So really, the expenses can vary. Our CPAC trip we take every year, that will be one of the kind of more expensive projects in the past that's been done. But I do think there's a lot more we can do with the budget by generating some new ideas for activism moving forward.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So we're going to talk a little more specifically about on-campus life. And there's the stereotype out there that most young people or most college students tend to be liberal and Democrats. And I believe that the numbers from the past election cycles show that that's overwhelmingly true for whatever reason. So my question is why are most college students Democrats? or why are they voting Democrat?
I think a lot of it has to do with the social issues. Gay marriage, abortion, all those issues are really tied to emotion. And so you get a lot of students that are really passionate about that, that are liberal, more or less. I guess if you're talking school to school, I have a pretty moderate campus. We do fairly well recruiting for Republicans, and I know the Democrats do well too. But if you were to look at Danny, it's like much different story. So,
right. And to give a little bit more of a quantified look at that, like I did the canvassing, organized canvasses at McAllister, St. Thomas, Hamlin, St. Cloud, all across the state. And the data at McAllister turned up more like 95% Democrat Obama supporters. Whereas at St. Thomas, it's downright conservative. It's much more like 50-50. Depending on your hall, too. And that's the thing I want to really stress, is that when we say most young people are Democrats, we have to understand that it's not most young people necessarily. Like, maybe on the whole it is. But on each college campus, there's a different culture. So that our college Republicans at Bethel and Northwestern, who did great work in the last election, we turned out some good results from those campuses, are very heavily conservative, whereas McAllister is one of the most liberal colleges in America. When I started there in 2010, it was actually ranked as the most liberal college in America, and, well, the next year we won Chapter of the Year. So McAllister is an extremely liberal place, and St. Thomas would probably fall somewhere in the middle there. Every campus has its own culture, and part of the job as chair, I think, is to understand those differences that exist and really mobilize, understanding the unique situation at each campus, mobilize students with a really local effort there.
You know, that's interesting that you bring that up about McAllister. Is I actually visited one of the political science classrooms last year, and I was telling the students there how I was excited to be there, because right in that backyard I used to play when I was a kid, because I grew up in Tangletown in that neighborhood surrounding McAllister. And I asked the classroom to raise their hands of how many people were from St. Paul. Nobody raised their hand. They said, how many are from the Twin Cities? I don't think anybody raised their hand, and some of them were from Minnesota. So I think that's probably maybe one big difference between McAllister's. You get a lot of students that are coming from California and other parts of the country that I just found that somewhat ironic. And about University of St. Thomas,
right.
Famously in 2010, out of all of St. Paul, that was the one ray of hope in the entire city of St. Paul in terms of the vote between Republicans and Democrats. It was basically 50-50 in that area. And if you look at the map, the election maps, you'll see one tiny little dot right in the middle of St. Paul, and that's where the University of St. Thomas electorate is. So,
and that came into play when we were trying to turn out the votes for Andrew Ojeda, too. So that really did help him out, and I'm glad it did.
Yeah. It's a good area. It's right where I grew up. I grew up right on Selby and Wilder over there, so know the area very well. You had mentioned social issues, and in particular, with the marriage amendment and the issue of marriage, you see a tremendous split in this issue amongst Republicans, and quite often you can actually measure this split by age. You know, older, more senior Republicans tend to be more socially conservative, and younger Republicans tend to be more socially liberal. And I just wanted to touch basis quickly on your viewpoints of specifically social issues, and specifically how you voted on the marriage amendment and why, and whether you're pro-life or pro-choice, why or why not. So,
I'm pro-life. I grew up in a Catholic household, and I don't think it's right that I don't believe in abortion. I think that's the wrong way to go. Going on the social issue of marriage, personally at St. Thomas, the Vote No campaign made huge headway there, and so we had to be really careful as a chapter. That's not really something I focused on this past fall. It was getting people to phone banks. It was getting people to go out on Sundays and door knock and lit drop for different candidates. And so I stayed away from the marriage issue because I didn't want to divide a chapter in election year. But personally, I believe that marriage is between a man and a woman. However, I think the government needs to be open to civil unions. So,
Danny?
Yeah. Again, like Andrew, I'm personally pro-life and would legislate that way if I was some kind of state representative, state senator, whatever. A life is a life is a life to me. But on the gay marriage issue, I did personally vote no on the marriage amendment. But the important thing I think to note on that issue, or on any issue really, is that the college Republican chairman's job isn't to pick winners and losers in legislative battles. I'm in this because I believe in certain principles. I believe in limited government. I believe in individual liberty, and I believe in free markets. And that's why I bother to work in politics so hard, to dedicate my life to trying to make a difference. But as chairman, I understand that there's going to be honest disagreements between me and Andrew, between you and myself. That's going to happen, and that's a good thing. We don't want a bunch of people who agree with each other, and that's part of the reason I went to McAllister. I definitely don't agree with the majority of my campus on a majority of issues. And so when that's the case, the College Republicans' job is to make sure that College Republicans at Bethel and Northwestern feel just as welcome as College Republicans from McAllister. These groups that have maybe different cultures, maybe even different worldviews in some instances, but really we're united by free markets, individual liberty, small government. You know, that's what being a Republican is all about. And so my job is to make sure that we're working to get Republicans to win, and then those people can fight for our values. They might disagree on the little issues, but on the big picture, we're in the same fight.
Okay, thanks for answering those. Let's move on from campus life and let's go backwards a bit and reflect on 2012 election cycle. And my question for you is, can you give specific examples of specific candidates and campaigns that you either helped directly or use your leadership within College Republicans to help directly, and what were the results of those efforts, and perhaps even what did you learn from them?
Sure, definitely. I'd love to talk about that. St. Thomas, College Republicans as a chapter, put forward more than 630 hours of volunteer hours for campaigns this fall. And I'm glad and honored that I've had the chance and opportunity to serve with those individuals that have worked so hard alongside myself. Going to specific candidates that we helped win, our former vice chair of College Republicans, Jake Cordes, ran for school board in Farmington. And we went down there on homecoming. It was about 40 degrees and raining. And we door knocked and lit dropped for about 2.5-3 hours in the pouring rain. And we had a great time. He later went on to win that one. And so we were very happy. He was one of the few candidates on election night that won, that we helped. We helped Mark Uglum up in Champlin. He was the former mayor. And we door knocked and lit dropped for him one Sunday afternoon. I came out in full Vikings gear, so that was quite fun. And then he won 51-49 in his race, so we definitely helped him. And then, of course, we helped Keith Downey. He was not successful in his bid for state senate. We helped Eric Paulson. We helped Andrew Ojeda, who unfortunately wasn't successful in his bid either. So, and then besides the phone banking, every Thursday night, you know, and whenever we could.
Nice. Danny?
Yeah. So for the 2012 election for me, it was really quite the juggling effort, because while being a full-time student, I was also serving as the campaign manager for Andrew Ojeda, who's my friend at McAllister, who ran for state house against now House Majority Leader Aaron Murphy. And so while managing his campaign, I was also doing my role as the vice chair Metro, which really entailed organizing. Every Thursday night, we'd go phone bank for John Klein. I helped turn people out for that. Across campuses in Minnesota, I also sometimes filled in for the job of my friend Tim as youth director for the Kurt Bills campaign, which, while the Kurt Bills campaign, the interesting thing is that while the performance wasn't so strong across the entire electorate, that on college campuses, we saw in places like Bethel's precinct and St. Thomas's precinct, he did much better than you would have than the general electorate relative to Republicans, how they would typically do among young voters. And a lot of that was just the simple work of talking to people, knocking on doors and dorms and college campuses across the state, and whether it was McAllister, St. Thomas, St. Cloud, wherever. So that was a big part of my time. Also a phone banking for various candidates like Klein, like Bachman, whoever it may be. So as far as the specifics go, it was door knocking on college campuses. It was working to organize phone banks. It was running my own campaign, or running the campaign of Ojeda right here in the middle of St. Paul. So all those things gave me a really varied experience in the 2012 election.
Good, good. And Dallas, we have a caller. Does the caller have a question specific to College Republicans?
Or? We'll have to ask.
Okay, we'll find out then. Yes, caller, can you hear us?
Hi, is this Tony?
Yes, it is.
Tony, this is Pam Sears from York, Minnesota.
Uh-huh. Yes, Pam.
I love your show. I'm a big fan.
Thank you.
And I have two questions today. First, it seems that state governments are still really struggling to balance their budgets, and we know they can't rely on the federal government for assistance. So don't you think it's time for states like Minnesota to legalize and tax the sports booking industry for extra revenue? It's a harmless hobby that's going on all over the country, but only Nevada and a couple other places have been smart enough to bring in tax revenue on sports books. So shouldn't the state cash in rather than just making the bookies rich off of black market betting?
Caller, thank you so much for the call. We're going to put your questions on hold, though, as we finish up the debate with the College Republican chair. So if you could hold on about 5 minutes here, we'll get back to you for your questions, okay? Okay, so thank you for answering those questions.
Can't say a lot about sports booking, but
yeah. it's a good question that we'll get to. So here's an important question. Looking forward to 2014, will Governor Dayton and Senator Franken be retired? And what will you do as the Minnesota College Republican chair in 2013 that's going to lay the foundation or lay the groundwork in order to bring a new statewide leadership to Minnesota?
I'm excited to answer that question. Yes, I think Senator Franken's going to be retired, and yes, I think Mark Dayton is going to be retired as well. Mark Dayton, especially after his budget that he submitted that he doesn't believe in himself, a very vulnerable candidate. I think Senator Franken is also very vulnerable as well, as long as we put up a good candidate. But what I can do with College Republicans, looking at 2014, is to expand and get students excited, just like I did at St. Thomas, at a state level, and be able to assist them and be as strong as possible, ready to go, develop contingency plans, making sure that continuity is good, and that we just keep everything intact after a good, successful term, I hope to have.
Danny, can Dayton and Franken be defeated in 2014?
They definitely can, but if you look at any of the polling numbers, it's going to be hard. We can't shirk away from the fact that this is going to be a challenge for us. And so when that's the case, we have to ask, where can we gain ground that we haven't in the past? And while it's good to have college Republicans be foot soldiers for campaigns across the state in a general way, I think we can also focus more on making the difference on college campuses. Young people right now are some of the stronger demographics for Democrats, but the interesting thing I found when I was door knocking at like the University of Minnesota or St. Cloud, I would ask people, what do you think about President Obama? And they'd be like, I don't know. And then they would realize I was working on politics, and they'd ask, aren't I supposed to vote no or something? Now, whatever you think about those issues, you would expect people to have a greater understanding than that. And part of that is our fault. We have to have those conversations with people. And so I think the college Republicans can really focus on, can select precincts. There's like 20 some odd precincts across the state that are really college student majority, that we can look at the margins and say, you know, there's a lot of variability in the election results here, where we saw Republicans sometimes do well and sometimes not. We can make a difference in those places where the traditional party structure cannot. That's why the college Republicans are slightly independent from the state party. We have a great working relationship with them, but we're also distinct because as college students, we have a unique voice that we can bring to other college students and tell them this is why we believe in small government, this is why we believe in liberty, and you should too. If we can have those conversations, if we can put the resources towards having those conversations, we can make a difference in 2014 and really help retire both Dayton and Franken.
Okay. Before we get to your closing statements, I just want to ask one last question, and there is no right or wrong answer for this. But could you please tell the audience who your favorite historical Republican leader has been? Mm-hmm. And then also the second part of the question is, who, in your opinion, which Republican leader best exemplifies the future or the face of the Republican Party?
I definitely have to say, for my favorite conservative, I'm going to have to go with Calvin Coolidge. It's not one you hear a whole lot. President during the 1920s, he saw the American economy grew significantly during his term. He was a proponent of small government, you know, low taxes, and everything I believe in, and it worked out really well. And he was a soft-spoken man, didn't speak a whole lot, was straight to the point. I like that. Looking at the future, Marco Rubio, definitely my favorite, read his book. He's definitely on number one for my political bucket list of someone I want to meet. And it's because he's a breath of fresh air, being a Cuban from Florida. He has a story. His dad was a bartender, his mom was a maid at a hotel. He's got a fabulous story, he's very well spoken, and he can communicate the ideas of the Republican Party very clearly.
Well, as far as historical figures go, Senator Barry Goldwater would have been one of the, I think, is should be given a lot of credit for making the Republican Party what it is today. Regardless of the fact that he didn't do so great in the presidential race, he really set the ideological foundation for our success today in the future, today, like in even in 2010, 1994, when we saw waves of conservatives really stand up for what they believed in and win. A lot of that foundation was laid by Senator Goldwater. Looking forward into the future, I'm going to throw a really obscure name out at you, or at least obscure for people living in Minnesota, which is Representative Thomas Massie. Now, Massie's a U.S. representative from Northern Kentucky, which you might think, why would he be a national figure worth looking at? But if you look at Massie's background, he's from rural Kentucky. And this is a kid who, when he was in high school, he started doing the science fair circuit and got some attention because his experiments were pretty good. Well, he ended up getting a big scholarship to MIT. Once there, he started making inventions. He got his engineering degree. He became a self-made multimillionaire even. And this is someone who I like to look at as the future, because just like the Minnesota College Republicans have different cultures on each campus, whether it's Northwestern, McAllister, St. Thomas, Thomas Massie really represents the fact that you can believe in the ideas of a farmer and the ideas of an engineer, be pro science while also respecting rural traditions, and really all come together under the same ideas, under the same vision we have for America. So that's what I want to see the college Republicans look like, and I hope Massie can really showcase in the future that kind of unifying these really distinct threads into one worldview that we can all stand behind.
Okay. Finally, we're just going to have you give your closing statement, your concluding statement. It can be anywhere from 30 to 60 seconds, and feel free to add any information that you feel like we didn't cover, your website, Twitter, hashtag, whatever it is that you want the audience to know about you and about your campaign. So who started? Was it?
I started.
You started. So Danny, why don't you go first then?
Sure.
With your concluding statement?
Yeah. So again, I'm Danny Surman. Go to McAllister College, and really, when it comes down to it, I hope you will support me for my run, because going to school at McAllister, being able to have the experiences I had fighting with the college Republicans over the last 3 years on college campuses, whether it was hard places like McAllister, easier ones like Bethel or Northwestern, whatever it may be, I feel like I've had a wide variety of experiences and a wide variety of roles as campaign manager, as a vice chair of the College Republicans, as a chapter chair, all these different things, starting my own chapter from scratch. The school promised us there was a chapter, but it wasn't really there when we got there. I think that really has given me a chance to learn all the different things I'll need to manage the College Republicans well. Now, if you want to learn more about the campaign, just go on Facebook, go on Twitter, just look up Team Surman, that's S-U-R-M-A-N, and there, I'm happy to talk to anyone. I'm on those platforms all the time, and I'll answer any questions you have. So thanks a lot.
Well, my name's Andrew Hasek. As I said, I go to St. Thomas, and I'm the chairman of College Republicans there. First of all, I'd like to thank Tony for having me on today. Danny as well, he's a good friend of mine. And while we're running against each other, I think we're going to have a good, clean campaign. Just going back to what I said, taking St. Thomas from a chapter that didn't matter into probably the largest and most active this past fall. I've had a great time working with students, not just at St. Thomas, but all across the state. And, I'm really hoping that I can win this in April. But if you want to follow the campaign, feel free to send me an email at teamhasek@gmail.com. We're on Facebook at Andrew Hasek for MNCR's chair, and Twitter at Team Hasek. So thank you, Tony.
Sounds good. Gentlemen, thank you for being on the show. Danny,
thanks a lot, Tony.
I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you, Andrew. And somebody will come by and help you to take off your microphone. So
sounds good.
It looks like the Minnesota College Republicans are going to be in good hands. I'm honored to have Andrew and Danny, both of them, here today to explain a little more about their candidacy, about their vision for the College Republicans in the future, and everything that it is that they plan on doing. So I'm really happy that they took the time to stop by to intercept themselves to you. And I would encourage you to look up more about their campaigns, Danny Surman, Team Surman on Twitter, and Andrew Hasek, it's Team Hasek, H-A-S-E-K, on Twitter as well. So thank you, gentlemen, for coming in. As we bring on Jake, I'm just going to talk a little more about this last week. It was a pretty incredible week, as I alluded to at the beginning of this show, and a lot of things happened this week. It was the beginning of Lent, Ash Wednesday. Preceding that, Catholics all around the world were shell-shocked, absolutely surprised to find out that Pope Benedict has decided to resign from being the Pope of the Catholic Church. A Pope has not resigned from the Catholic Church while they were living for something like 600 years. So this is a very rare and historical event. Pope Benedict said that his reason was his age and his health concerns, although a spokesman for the Pope has come out to say that he doesn't have anything specifically wrong with his health. There's nothing actually an immediate threat to his health. It's just more of a kind of a bigger picture. He's getting to the senior part of his ages, and he decided that he can't serve as a Pope. But I brought this picture in, Dallas, if you want to pop up the picture of lightning striking. This is the Basilica in Rome on the same day that Pope Benedict decided to resign, which was February 11th, 2013. And this is very interesting, not only that the lightning strikes the basilica, this picture went viral throughout the world, you know, people saying that this is some type of a sign, or perhaps it's some just random occurrence that happened to happen on the same day. But the rumors and are just swelling on the internet right now about what in particular is happening. And there was a saint, and his saint, Malachi is his name. He was an Irish saint, and I believe he was around in the 13th century. And he became famous because he made a series of predictions. One of the predictions that he ended up making was that there would only be 111 more popes from his point. And it turns out that Pope Benedict is the 111th pope, apparently, from St. Malachi. And according to this prophecy, he's the last pope. And you know, there's a number of rumors that are going around about this. I don't know, you know, how much truth there is. There's always people out there that can find some justification to bring light to some prophecy and whatnot. And to me, this just hammers home the idea that we have to be good people in this world. We need to pray on a daily basis. We need to recognize that there's a higher power, and we would all benefit as well from realizing that we're imperfect and realizing where our imperfections are and confessing those. So this is just, in my belief, another warning to solidify the idea that we should all be paying attention to this. What else happened this week? So Ash Wednesday hits, and you know, I actually had to go to the doctor that day, and I hadn't been to the doctor for nearly 6 years. And as many of you know, I experienced a traumatic accident at one point in my life. This was 6 years ago, actually. Somebody tossed a 12-pound rock from a bridge, and I was in a car going 70 miles an hour. It came through the windshield and smashed me on the right side of my abdomen and caused a major laceration in my liver, massive internal bleeding. It darn near killed me. And I went through a long, long recovery from that. And, you know, since my last surgical procedure, I had not gone back to the doctor. And so I went back at Leona. My wife was begging me to see the doctor, and I finally did. So lo and behold, all the tests I passed, my cholesterol is fine, blood pressure is fine, everything. The only thing that I was surprised about was when I stepped on the scale and saw how much I weighed. It was a lot more than what I've been telling the DMV and various employer applications and whatnot. I was shocked. I haven't stepped on the scale for a while. So, you know, it made me think that with Lent coming around and what's actually, you know, adding to my waistline and everything that's going on in the world, you know, as Catholics, we decide to give something up for Lent. And so this year, on a very serious note, I decided to give up alcohol. So for the next 40 plus days, I won't be drinking any beer, no wine, no liquor. And I'm really doing that as a sacrifice to raise awareness and to also give strength and hope to people who are suffering from alcoholism and addiction. This is a very serious issue that we face in our society. There are a lot of people who suffer from alcoholism and drug addictions, and it has an effect that ripples out to the core nucleus of the people that they love. Problems with crime, to drunk driving, to everything. So I'm giving up alcohol to help facilitate that process where people will find the courage to attain their spiritual moment so that they will stop drinking one day at a time. So hopefully, too, one of the positive benefits with this is if you see me week in, week out, that perhaps maybe I'll lose a little bit of weight here, too. So with that, I'm going to bring on my next guest, Jake Duesenberg. Thank you for coming on the show again.
Good to be back, Tony.
It was a big week, wasn't it?
Yeah. Well, I didn't give up alcohol, so it wasn't as big a week for me.
It's a pretty big thing, though, isn't it?
Yeah. You know, beer adds a lot to the waistline, and that's probably a pretty good idea to get rid of beer out of the diet. And I always, obviously, since college, have struggled a lot with the weight. You know, I'm not the slim 180-pound guy I was in college. I credit a lot of that to that nice malted beverage I like to enjoy on Friday and Saturday night.
It's true, yeah, and I don't really drink that much, but you know, I like to have a beer, and there is a lot of calories in there, and what they say, empty calories, you know, because there's not much nutrients unless you're drinking a Guinness or something like that. I hear you can actually live off a Guinness a day at least.
Well, there's actually a lot of health benefits in beer, to be honest with you.
Really?
It's just the calories are the bad part.
Yeah,
but there's protein in it, you know, from the malted barley, and a lot of vitamins in that. So, I mean, this is a good grain that, you know, a lot of farmers make a living off of. So there's actually a lot of health benefits from beer, but there's some downsides, obviously, you know.
Yeah, and I find that the older and older I get, the harder it is for me to, you know, I work out quite a bit, you know, and I run and I try to watch what I eat, and it seems that the more that I eat now, the more of an impact that it has on my weight. Do you find that same thing?
Oh yeah. Yeah. I mean, it was refreshing watching the college students here, cuz those days, you know, it was like fast food. You remember that? And there really weren't any consequences. I also got to work out twice a day in college. It was easier to do back then, but it's a lot easier to burn that extra calories.
No doubt about that. And if you don't believe us, why don't you go try to put on some of your jeans from college or that dress from college and see if there's any impact from that. So we're going to show, you know, one thing I forgot, you know, we're talking about what a big week it was with the Pope resignation, the State of the Union address.
Oh, that was this week?
That was this week.
I should have watched.
U.S. Senator Rubio's response to the State of the Union. We had Ash Wednesday, the beginning of Lent. But then also, I think one of the biggest news stories was the meteor.
That's right.
That fell in that remote part of Russia. So we're just going to play some of the footage from the meteor that hit. I believe it was in Siberia or you know, the remote region of Russia, and Dallas is going to put up the video. But I woke up that day. Was it Friday that hit?
Yeah, I think so. In fact, I had a friend who's serving in Afghanistan right now, and they heard he heard a boom, and he's kind of thinking maybe that's what he had heard.
Wow.
Yeah.
Well, I think Dallas has got this up, so we're just going to look at, you know, feel free to comment at this, but you know, you can see there's the skylines and you know, various. Is it moving right now? So yeah, I mean, and the interesting part was this was so well documented in Russia. Like, they actually caught it in a bunch of different cameras, which at first I was like, why were all these people filming this, you know, outside? How did this all happen? And it turns out in Russia, a lot of people have dashboard cameras in their cars. And I found this out because it was the Duluth. What's the newspaper in Duluth? I want to make sure that I give them credit for it, because they're the ones.
I don't know.
Well, anyways, they did a story about it, and they said that people have these dashboard cameras because of all the accidents that happen in Russia.
Sure.
And so they automatically have these things on in case you get in an accident. You have this dashboard camera that can, you know, tell the cops or the insurance people exactly, you know, what happened. So I thought that was pretty fascinating. But are we having problems playing it, Dallas? I thought it was interesting, and that's the reason why there was so much great footage caught of this meteor. Look at that thing.
Wow. I haven't even seen that video yet. That's crazy.
Yeah, this is from Russia Times, and you know. You know, the other thing I thought was amazing is these cameras have the audio on them, and you know, that you can hear the car music playing.
Yeah.
but the Russian people don't make any noise of reaction to this. They just keep driving like nothing's happening. And I was like, this is, if this happened in America, you know, if we had a camera playing and this happened to this guy, you know, depending on who it is, but I'd imagine you hear stuff like, holy beep, what the beep is that? But, you know, the Russians, for them, it was just like, ah. So maybe this kind of thing happens in Siberia more often.
Used to all that missile testing, so maybe that's what they thought it was.
Well, there are rumors about that they actually shot this thing out in the sky.
Oh, really?
I don't know if there's any truth to that or not.
Probably not.
Fascinating. I don't know. I think that outer space and objects that are orbiting in outer space and the threat of meteors is absolutely fascinating. And for mm-hmm. me, it makes me feel alive when I see something like that. I'm like, okay, we have maybe this is our last minute here on Earth. And if so, you know, that's what I was saying is so important, to do the right thing, to make sure you have a clean conscience, and, you know, to make sure that you're reaching out to a higher power too. So,
sure. Good idea.
But Jake, you and I, we're going to talk a little bit about in President Obama's State of the Union address, you know, he had mentioned that he wants to raise, not the debt ceiling, although he wants to raise that too, but he wants to raise the minimum wage.
Right.
And currently the federal minimum wage is at $7.25.
$7.25.
And he proposes to raise it somewhere from $7.25 to either $9, or there's a Minnesota state legislator that's proposing to move the state minimum wage even higher to $9.50. And, you know, on its surface, you know, if you're somebody who's making minimum wage, to you, that's a pay raise.
Right.
So if I'm making $7.25 an hour and all of a sudden that's bumped up to $9 or $9.50, you know, I'm making an extra $2 an hour, which is an extra $80 to $100 a week, which is an extra $500-something a month. It doesn't sound like such a bad deal to me. And I believe that people who are in these positions will actually find this proposal to be very attractive, because it directly impacts the amount of money that you take in. But what's your stance on this? Is raising the minimum wage a good idea, in your opinion? Is it the role of the federal government to even regulate the minimum wage?
So you're asking for my official response to the Obama State of the Union address? Well, I personally feel that... as my Rubio slam. minimum wage laws, they're a feel-good policy, okay? But they don't actually make a lot of sense when it comes down to it. Reason being, wages are prices, right? If you're offering your labor to a person that owns a business, that's a price, right? And every labor has a different price attached to it. We can't say all labor is equal, right? And everyone understands that. Tony, you've been in the mortgage business for a while, and I've had zero time in the mortgage business. So if we were applying for the same job with a mortgage company, you likely, your labor is probably worth more to that mortgage company than it is to me. No one could say that we both are worth the same amount of money. So this is really how the markets work, is that labor is a price, and minimum wage is a price setting by law. So if we know that it's a price, then let's take a look at who gets harmed the most by minimum wage laws. I would argue it's the people coming into the workforce for the first time, along with people that are coming back in for various reasons, disability-wise or incarceration. So people that have less skills for whatever reason is, but let's generally focus it on the young children, the teenagers, 16-year-olds that are entering the workforce for the first time. Why? They don't have a high school education, okay? And they don't have much work experience, if any at all. So their labor price is much lower than a typical person at age 30 who's probably worked a couple jobs, has a high school degree, and perhaps even has a college degree. So what ends up happening is you bring the price up of their labor to something that they can actually give a value to the business owner, you end up making it so that the business owner can't hire that individual. Very simple way to look at this is a kid, 16-year-old, no high school degree, no work experience. He's basically sweeping floors and mopping floors, which is an honest job for a 16-year-old. And this is one of his first ways to learn, you know, how a business works and operates, and you know, learning about leadership and on the job and the hard work that we value so much in this society. If his labor is not worth $9 to a business owner, and by law the business owner has to pay him $9, that kid will go unemployed and not pick up those skills. So that's really who gets affected the most. And I brought in a couple charts here. The hard thing about economics is you can't look at one chart and assume that it's a consequence of one policy. But we do see here in this chart since 1948, and I believe minimum wage laws have existed in some form since the mid to late 30s. But this is about when the Bureau of Labor Statistics, where I got these charts from, first started measuring this. But if you can see the unemployment rate among 16 and 19 year olds, the trend line has gone up since 1948, and today it's at about 24%. So since minimum wage laws have been on the books, I've seen a larger rise in unemployment for the 16 to 19 year olds, which would go along with what I've been saying here, are the people that are mostly affected by these policies. Now each state has different choices on how they want to deal with labor inside their boundaries, right? And I brought another chart, if Dallas could throw that up there. The national sales, national minimum wage is $7.25 right now. Mm-hmm. There is various states that have higher minimum wage laws and various states that have lower. And surprisingly, in the state of Minnesota, we are actually lower than the federal government's minimum wage standards. Washington, which I represent in the middle, is higher, and I believe, do I have it on there? My eyes aren't helping me out. $9.19, I believe, is the minimum wage for $9.19. Okay. So we actually have about a 10 percentage difference between the unemployment rate of 16 and 19 year olds between Washington, which has a higher minimum wage, than Minnesota, which has a smaller. And in Minnesota, right now, as you alluded to before, we're discussing bringing it up to somewhere like Washington State. Now, these are just two states. If you look at, I got one other chart here I brought in, the overall states, I think there's maybe a dozen or so states that have higher than the national average, and then I think only about four states that are below the national minimum wage. There's about a 3% difference between it. So, you know, like I said before, you can't just purely look at a chart and policies. And even in this one, it's very difficult because not all minimum wages per state are the same. Cultures are different between states. So it's very difficult. But generally speaking, when you look at the aggregate of all the states, there is still a lower unemployment rate in the states that have a lower minimum wage law than the states with higher. I would argue, as a free market guy, that we don't need a minimum wage law. Employers will figure out the right amount of money to pay people with a certain level of skills.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I would imagine that the proponents of minimum wage who are supporting this type of a proposal, I'd imagine that they are thinking that of the bigger picture. They're thinking of companies like Walmart and mm-hmm. Wells Fargo and these big banks and big corporations that, hey, they're sitting on all this cash right now. It's not a big deal if they have to pay their employees an extra $2 sure. per hour. They're going to see virtually no difference in their bottom line. They can pass some of this cost on to their consumers. They don't see perhaps the other angle of it, the small business man or woman who is deciding whether or not they want to hire somebody.
Yeah.
And I'm assuming that this minimum wage affects anyone who's a W-2'd employee, is that right?
Right, hourly employee.
Okay, so, you know, I was thinking of some of the consequences that could occur from raising the federal minimum wage, and it's already actually happening on different levels. But what you're seeing, at least in the lending business, and one of the reasons why it's harder and harder for a lot of people to qualify, and the actual pool of qualified borrowers is declining, mm-hmm. is because more and more people are moving from being W-2'd to being 1099'd or mm-hmm. a contracted
sure.
Type person, where it's a lot harder to qualify for a loan if you don't have W-2'd income. So do you think that would be an impact of raising the minimum wage, as the response would be businesses stop providing the benefit of a W-2 to their employee and they start privately contracting?
No, I don't see that, because generally speaking, you're talking about someone that's got a little bit more work experience. A W-2 employee, in this case with a minimum wage, is probably someone with lower skills and generally speaking aren't going to know what to do with a 1099. The difference here, someone that's just doing a consulting or contracting is also liable for 15.3% of their income going to Social Security, and they file taxes differently than just receiving a W-2 at the end of the year. So I guess I don't really see it going that way. But the interesting thing about this first part of your question was the Democrats that want the minimum wage laws increased think that it's the big Walmarts and the big corporations that will end up footing this bill, and they can do it because they're sitting on a lot of cash, right? Or they'll pass on the consumer. But just think about that question. They'll pass on the consumer, and we are the consumers. So there's no real magic pot of money these people have that doesn't come back and hurt either an investor or a customer, and that has ramifications for the overall economy. So this is just a feel-good policy that's really not following any economic rational thought.
What would you say to I read an article on Think Progress.
Okay.
So it's a progressive blog type website, and they are strongly in favor of raising the minimum wage. And one of the consequences that they said is that by having people getting paid more on the lowest income levels, that they'll actually be able to increase demand for products and services for businesses. So they're making the argument that by actually raising the minimum wage, you're increasing demand for
productivity, you're saying?
Mm-hmm. And what do you say about that?
Well, I mean, that's a horrible argument. I mean, if paying an employee more money increases productivity, then you don't need the government mandating it. They're going to pay. If I'm a business owner, which I am actually, but I don't have hourly workers, if I could get more productivity from someone by paying them a higher wage, I'm going to do it because it's good for me and it's good for them. So it's a terrible argument that, you know, Think Progress would make. And I've heard that one before. It doesn't make any sense. Mm-hmm. You don't need a law to tell a business owner what's going to increase productivity. Mm-hmm. And they're generally going to be wrong about that, too.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So is this, have you done much of the research? Is this going to pass on a federal level, or... Because there are Republicans in favor of raising the minimum wage. It's not a straight party divide on this issue.
I don't know, Tony, to be honest with you. This is a Congress that can't pass a budget, so I wouldn't put much past them. The Congress that decided that a federal health care system is good for us. So there's a good chance, yes, that it could pass. The effect of it, this is not a doom and gloom effect. It, like I say, it affects mostly the 16 to 19 year olds. But I'm guessing you were just like me. My first job was baling hay on a farm in Wisconsin. Then I was pushing carts at a grocery store. And, especially the pushing carts thing, I don't think they could afford $9 an hour nowadays. I don't think the value was there for a grocery store, especially that live on very slim profit margins. Yeah.
Well, you bring up a good point that the purpose of minimum wage is not to sustain a family.
Right.
In contradiction to what President Obama said, the purpose of the minimum wage or those types of jobs are to lift you up, to give you economic mobility so that you advance yourself. And nobody wants to be on minimum wage for the rest of their life.
No, they don't. So. That's true.
But Jake, we're coming to the end of our time here. Thanks for being on again.
Definitely.
I look forward to having you next week.
Always good.
And this is the Tony Hernandez Show. I thank you all for tuning in. We broadcast live every Saturday. Please tell your friends, your family about this show, and watch it on Facebook. May God bless you. May God bless America. And vaya con Dios.